playing is just off the top of his head.
Yeah, right.
But if you hear him play the same, like hear him play that song 10 times, you will hear the same kind of motions.
Yeah, that's beautiful what you're just playing.
Well, thank you. Thanks. I guess, you know, to a certain extent, some of it was worked out, I guess, somewhere along the line, you know. Slowly, you know, play tunes real slow.
There's a lot of pretty motion in what you're doing. I'm sure George would really appreciate it.
I've actually been trying to get in touch with him for about the past year or two. I haven't really called him that much.
He's a tough guy. He protects his
privacy. I wrote him one or two letters, and I've left maybe about 4 or 5 messages on his machine.
No response.
No response.
Yeah, he's always been tough that way.
Really?
He's been hurt.
I'm glad to hear that, because I thought maybe I just sounded like an idiot on the phone.
No. George is a very sensitive guy under a facade, not a facade, forgive me, a veneer of breezy elegance. But he's actually a man who's very easily hurt, and people have hurt him before. They've abused him. He's a man of exquisite kind of manners and elegance, even though he's got street savvy too, because he was around as a jazz musician.
Well, that's why I don't want to show up on his front door.
No. You don't want to. You're right. But he's the kind of guy that if you're courteous and polite, and if you have a sharp mind, which I can tell you do, that goes a long way with him. So he's just met too many guys that didn't know they were being rude. They would just, maybe they did show up on his door and just say, "Hey, can I come in, George? You're the heaviest guy."
I know somebody who did
even
that.
With nice intent, like, "You're the heaviest guy in the world," and George probably couldn't turn it down. Well, okay, come on in. And then he's thinking, "Wow, what I just, I'm busy. I'm just reading scrapbooks of my old love letters I wrote to my wife or something. She's dead now." You know, he's not in the mood to talk about, "Gee, do you hold down all diminished triads when you have those?"
You can't just show up on something. I mean, people have.
But our culture doesn't teach that, you know. I used to be more insensitive to those things myself, so I can see it now from both angles.
One of the first questions right off about technique.
Don't need lessons, by the way. You certainly don't need guitar lessons.
Well, gosh, I don't know.
Oh, man, I just heard what you can do, that you don't need guitar lessons.
Well, I don't use any rest strokes, and I was wondering, I'm getting a classical guitar made by Carl Barney. It's a flat nylon 7-string.
Remember you mentioned.
With a low A. Now, you know, sometimes I wish maybe it was a high A when I listen to Lenny stuff. And also now Phil DeGree, you know. Mm-hmm. So, one of the questions is about rest strokes. Do you think it's necessary to bring out the melody? Or, you know, because it doesn't sound like George is using a whole lot, but I know Lenny used to do it.
Yeah, actually George does use some rest strokes sometimes.
Yeah, is that right?
Yeah, he gets a lot of nail in his sound. Yeah, she does.
Yeah.
And Lenny is all nail most of the
long,
time. All
long nail.
Seldom any flesh. I don't think it's necessary because I know what it sounds like when there's no nail from my own playing. That's how I play. So, and I've heard it back on tape enough times where I was having a decent enough day where you could hear the melody enough and you didn't go, "Oh, this guy, let him grow some nails and send him home." You know, so it depends on what you love, which tone. Lenny's sure got that exquisite kind of tone for a guy playing with all nails. Sometimes it's pretty warm.
Really nice. I mean, when I would see his nails so long, and I've heard countless interviews, and I have a videotape with him with Chet Atkins and Leona Boyd, you know, playing for like 15 minutes, and he's saying, "Oh, I should have done my nails, you know, they're too long."
he was real fussy about his nails.
Yeah.
Definitely.
But I understand that you met him.
Oh, yeah, we were buddies.
Yeah. Because he, it was something I was reading about that you used to stretch for some chords, and he put a harmonic in the bass.
Oh yeah, I remember that story.
Put that harmonic.
It was pretty accurate, actually, even though it was the time frame might have been weird or something. But the concept was accurate. Where I remember doing that, him smiling at me, and then me go, "No, man, you can't get it that. Oh, look at how he's getting that chord. I don't believe, you know, one of those."
Yeah.
Yeah, he blew my mind a few times. That was good. It's good to have those experiences sometimes, right? He was so wonderful.
Well, I think my big dilemma right now, I feel like I'm sort of at a plateau and I can't get to that next level. And part of the problem is that this may not be a problem, but, you know, I started playing the guitar pick style and did the bebop thing, you know, totally
single
into string, that.
Single string cap?
Single line and then just comping grips, you know.
I see.
The common shapes. Now, what I wrote here is a question.
Okay.
Do you think a bebop style can be developed from the Van Epp style, with melody playing a fundamental role, while still having all of the, you know, like the beautiful inner lines and the bass lines happening? Do you think that can,
you're
can be
talking Charlie
a,
Parker
can,
above
yeah,
a viola line and a bass line?
Yeah.
So to speak.
Yeah.
You want a soft drink, by the way?
Bottle of water would be fine.
Bottle of like that bottle of water stuff?
Yeah, thank you. I should have brought it in from the
car.
No
problem.
You like
thank
it
you.
Real cold or?
That would be
got,
fine.
Got it in the fridge.
Great.
That's that bouncy kind of George-like melody.
Yeah, I try to keep the halftime bass going, you know? Just because I noticed when I would be doing gigs on solo guitar, you know, people would be trying to tap their foot and everything, and George really does that kind of stuff. But
he's a cut time man.
Half note, quarter notes maybe or something.
Yeah, he's a cut time man.
Yeah.
It's a buoyant kind of feel.
And, you know, what I'm having trouble with is that Lenny had a real bebop approach because he would punctuate those chords and get that rhythm happening.
Those two cats are a million miles apart.
Yeah.
They're more dissimilar.
They're really coming
than similar.
From
there's almost nothing in common. Resultant sound. Same with Wes. He doesn't sound like either one of those guys.
Yeah.
And Ed Bickert sounds different than all of them, except he's a little more like Lenny, if you had to say which one is he closest to.
I agree. Yeah.
So each guy's got his thing, you know?
Sounds a lot like Jim Hall, too, I think.
There's some Jim Hall there. Yeah, there's kind of an understated quality that Jim is, shall we say, well known for.
But
we have a D. Please, I'll turn to you.
Okay, sure. I'll turn it down. You want me to turn you up?
You know what I want you to do? To put a reverb on some last note on the right, since you're supposed to make it about like 12 o'clock instead of so far.
Okay.
Maybe even 11 o'clock today. Now, I'm going to turn this down, and if you turn my volume up on the amp a little more, like maybe up to about 1 or 2 o'clock.
Okay.
Then I can run it and get some different control off the speaker without being harsh.
I've got him playing with a Bucky Barrett.
I would put it over there. Just
really?
If there's magnetism. The
I was thinking about that.
Bucky Barrett's a pretty nice player. You have a tape of those guys.
I have a few of those, actually.
Yeah, I think somebody circulated one of those to me, too, as a matter of fact.
Yeah.
It's old, from the 70s.
Yeah, it's from, I think, from 77 at the Mississippi Whisper or something like that.
And the crowd goes absolutely nuts. Is that the one where when Lenny plays?
Yeah.
The crowd just explodes, man, like on that Tal Farlow thing, when Lenny gets done playing, the crowd's just like at a rock concert or something. They're just crazy.
No, I've got that too. Yeah.
So, when you say bebop, doesn't have to be bop, or do you
because
beret and sunglasses kind of.
I like post bop, and I like the McCoy, and even some of the Train stuff, you know, that's a little out there.
You're being realistic then. See, then you can get something like you've asked for.
Yeah.
If you just say bebop, the closest to it that I've ever heard, and you probably have heard it by now, and maybe you've heard it by now, is Charlie Hunter's approach.
Yeah, I hear he's playing, I think, tonight.
Really? Is he in town?
I think he's playing at the House of Blues. It might even be tonight.
But with his
rock ensemble, you know, I think there's...
So you've heard him play?
Yes, I have.
So you know what he's doing. He's playing Bach lines, or Coltrane-type lines, or comping chords over a decidedly organish, real rapid bass when he feels like it. He's not doing three things, though. He is doing two.
Bass and melody.
bass and melody or bass
or
and bass
chords.
You're asking if you could play a bass line, an inner viola part, a French horn line, and a line on top. You know the answer to that is yes. You know you could do it. You just have to love it enough to go after it. Now, the tempo is just going to be something that's going to be a lifelong battle. You know, if someone says, all right, play Oleo here, and you say, with a viola line inside, huh?
No.
But see, that's one thing that, you know, in that interview you did with George, he said, you know, people can't hear when the lines are going that fast.
I remember that.
You can't really hear
it. Cut them in half. The whole thing was going like a jackrabbit or something.
Yeah, exactly. Right. What I want to try to do would be play like Lenny with maybe a little more bass in there, you know?
I can understand that.
Because he's got the compen thing. But you know, maybe it's from having the seventh string and working through the George stuff, you know, because I was sort of into George before Lenny, you know, and
I sure hear it. A lot of George in there, my goodness.
I definitely hear a lot of Lenny stuff.
Don't look. I'm going to just do something. You may know this, just for the fun of it, since we're just doing this casually. I just want you to be surprised.
Okay.
So if I do this, let's see if I got this right.
Can I look now?
I'm not quite ready yet.
That's mixing everything up there, yeah.
Well, it's pretty much George's thing now. I'm just trying to imitate George's thing. I've got a tune where these strings are simulating his low strings, and I've omitted string 5, so to speak.
Okay.
Like I said, A.
You could get that all the way down to A on there.
Well, actually, I'm lucky that this guitar is not a heavy. If it were real heavy, it would vibrate well down there.
Right, I see.
It's a little tubby, to say the least, but the amp is 115. It's a
that's
poor
wild.
Man's real cheesy bass down there. If you really listen to the tone, it's kind of tubby. But
I think this guitar sounds kind of like that too.
Oh,
actually.
I don't believe so. No, when you played it, I noticed it was actually pretty clear, like George's.
Good.
But if you. I mean, that's the Van Epps kind of thing I hear you doing.
Yeah.
That's a conversational style, is the way I think.
Like the lines are playing off each other?
They do. The bass answers quite a bit. When he plays bass, he's not a walking bass man, as you mentioned before, although I suspect if he felt like it, he might be able to. But he likes to answer things with the bass, or just keep kind of a steady thing on one note, or a steady thing on the half notes, as you mentioned. But his dialogue ability with the bass is certainly apparent every now and then. Every now and then. And then I said, God, I wish he'd do that more, you know? Because I just love it when he does it. To do the Lenny style, like you said, with more bass, you could think about doing. See, but now, again, we're not talking viola lines so much anymore. We're just talking about good voice leading on the other parts.
Okay.
Well, I wish I could make that note there. It loves being there, but it has to come there. Start out with maybe it's more of a Lenny-ish pianistic texture than traditional 1958 onward comping with a little melody dialogue, and then every now and then you just freeze those where they are and start talking in the bass,
right,
which seems to bring in the Van Eppsian quality little special, you having that deep. It's just, without meaning to sound too weird, it's just like sex, man. You gotta pace the whole thing and withhold certain elements. So it's just, you gotta, during the course of the evening, the cool thing is not to give people the base after you have for a while. Hold back.
Right.
Let them get hungry for it again, then give it to them, man. That's really the way it is. If I go to hear somebody like George and he's not using the bass after he teased us and gave it to us, I'm waiting. But if he's using it all the time, then I'm starting to get jaded. I'm hearing it. That's what I meant before about my ear gets so into it, because I overuse it when I have it. I can't stand not to play it. After a week, I'm burned out of it.
I see what you're saying.
If I could do what I'm telling you to do personally while I'm just practicing, it would be great. But I just lust for the damn note down there, man. I have it. So, we can go through a song. We can use a song like, let's use Embrace Will You, what the
okay,
hell?
Okay, sure.
What key was it? G or something?
G, yeah.
G? Yeah. Okay. So if you play, I mean, we're going to consciously not do this.
Okay.
Because I already know you can do that.
Yeah.
No, but it's good. All that kind of stuff you were doing is excellent. We're going to try a different approach where you don't use the bass, maybe.
Let me try that and see if
maybe you've got the style we got. So now we're looking at this is a basic thing, because we can always hear the root or be on a gig with a bass player and have them.
Right.
So this is our, I've ended up too sharp to, Johnny Smith would kill me for this, I don't know personally. Although he did play in my home once when I was a little kid.
Really?
I was just a little kid.
Oh,
I got all these autographs in the back. Hope to hear you pick sometime. Keep plugging. Dad says you're doing well. You know, I've been playing like 3 weeks or something.
Was your father?
My father loved music. My mom loved music. My grandma. So they just hired the whole damn band. They drove up from New York City a few miles off the coast there and played my home. But I was a kid, man. I was already asleep or something.
I missed the whole thing.
I missed the whole thing. Well, I might have been at a party chasing the puberty aspect of life. So, this is normal territory harmonically. If you want that, if you want those beautiful close ones, you gotta work hard for those. You know the four-part close?
Right.
Those don't pretty
sound like Chicago. Chicago. Okay.
Right.
So you just voice split it down like this?
Actually, I was just going backwards over the voice just so that your ear would record, or the tape if it's wrong.
Right.
They're all just G chords.
G major 6.
Like G6, G major 9, and then G.
That is nice.
6. Sometimes it's fun to thin the texture out, and then later when you do bring.
Yeah.
Not only doing it with string 6, but you bring in string 7, man. Just rock the rafters. But anyway, back to the whole idea of different textures and getting the Lenny thing with the George, the mine.
Yeah.
So we have this basic harmony. Or, can you see my hands okay?
Yeah.
Yeah, it could be a. Actually, this won't voice it right. You could actually start behind the chord harmonically. Like on a 5,
right?
You lead into it, and then you're on a 1. So, that's giving people the pedal tone bass right in the beginning. As far as moving lines, let's see. I'm just simulating some of the stuff I was hearing you doing without the,
I like
getting
the
low
part
bass.
Kind of two or three part kind of stuff without the bass, yeah.
This is like some of those come right out of classical music. You know?
Right.
If you drop the bass, what would you get here?
Like when you drop sort of things, like, are you thinking of a particular chord? Are you thinking of the individual lines? Because
it's visual and auditory at this point where I'd like to say that it was all planned out, but all I'm doing is praying I'll get to a place where the diminished will be possible. At the, you know,
like on a dominant chord or something?
I mean, on the next chain, it's supposed to be diminished.
Yeah.
Because I'd like to get that change there, the first chorus,
uh-huh.
Just to acknowledge Gershwin's original change. I like it.
Right.
Later, I'm probably going to go for a subdominant substitute, like a C9 or an A13.
Instead of the diminished. Then.
Yeah. I like those modern 11th colors instead of diminished. Or diminished with extensions.
Yeah, I tend to stick too much to the original chord changes.
Like this thing. I like this wave in this chord, which if you hear it this way.
Sort of altered dominant.
Yeah, it sounds like one of those. But in the context of this, this is a maniac chord. I like the voice leadings. Let me play it the way I would do it if I were trying to think about Lenny and George and all that. Need help with that? I've got another machine if it's not doing what you want it to do.
No, I think it is. Just turn it up a little.
I'll get the little wedding colors in there.
Sounded like Limehouse Blues.
Yeah. Wow. All I could do there to get the Lenny thing was just the rhythm that he might have used, but the voices were completely not Lenny. Lenny would have gone. Something like this chord for the high point or this one.
Yeah.
Might have done this. I tried to study his voicings a lot because he just knocked me out with how cool his chords were, you know. Neighbor's not calling. Hi. Tony.
I wanted to check out, you know, different approaches to soul guitar.
I wish I could do the thing that you're asking exactly. I'd have to sit and really work out that myself.
Oh, I guess. Well, you are doing it. You are doing it.
Sometimes I'll just get nutty and play like, you hit a chord like this, and I notice you're really involved in counterpoint inside of your arrangement, which I love.
I'm trying. Yeah.
So if I hit a chord like that, and I'm not satisfied to just linger there, I'll just start taking off the chord until something else shows up that seems harmonically germane, like in this case, these lines. Skipped a note there, so I'm going to call Mr. Detention Session.
compic chords to the fourth and third strings, or the
absolutely not
the more of the fifth and fourth.
That's exactly what he did.
Yeah.
5 and 4 for two part. Very rarely 5 and 6 for two part.
Yeah.
Most of his comping is 3 notes plus a top note as
right.
a minimum. He would demonstrate it and teach it as 2 note. And there are moments in his pieces
that's
you can hear him go absolutely thin down to 2 in the low end.
Yeah.
But generally, he's a 3 note cat in the low end.
Yeah.
He loves that. As are the pianists that he admired. They were generally telling him by their playing, and probably a few of the guys, Bob Erwinson and those cats, by their instruction, play just 3 notes, man, and then add a melody. You know, that's why.
Yeah.
That's why you get so much of that. So embraceable with these chords if you're a comp and backing a singer. Not in. Now, do you do any of that where you play concerts?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So you would do something like maybe. Let me make an exception. Sometimes he would hit a root, whereas he generally never plays roots down here. That's
hmm.
the bass player's game.
Yeah, he didn't
so
do that.
I'll do this again. Maybe you'll ask me a question if this is helpful at all.
Okay.
Diminished.
That was built up in up a fourth and up a third. Like a major triad?
You're on the right track. What happens is every time you see a standard diminished 7 or diminished 6, whatever you prefer,
right.
this chord has 4 extensions that are primary ones in that they're in the scale that's commonly heard these days as that sound, right? That stock scale?
The diminished scale. Yeah
the diminished scale. It has 4 extensions. Maybe you know this, Steve, so forgive me if you do. They're a whole step above every note in there, or anywhere.
Right, or a half step below.
Or a half step below.
Or
good
a
man.
Major sixth above, or a minor.
Yeah, I don't even take it that far.
Above.
I just see each voice and just.
Yeah.
just
yeah.
All I remember is the letter names that are a whole step above and a half step below.
Right.
I sometimes combine them, like here, I'll split this and play.
So you just play notes from the scale, basically.
Yeah, in other words, if I do that, I'm playing the note that's a half step below and the one that's a whole step above. So instead of that,
so you'd be going like,
I'm going to split that. I'm going to take this note, pretend there are 2 of them.
Okay.
And I'm going to move one down a half step, as you mentioned.
Okay.
And the other up a whole step, right? Because that's where the extensions live.
Okay.
Then I keep the stop cat sitting around home there.
What? And what do you have on the third string there?
Same thing you did, the stock note.
Yeah, yeah.
You just lean your first finger if you're into lean the slant finger technique.
You do that, man.
Is this something that you don't prefer to do? Is lean
the like
finger?
the kind of thing?
You kind of curve and slant.
Oh, yeah, okay, yeah, I can do that.
George had to do that in his books, right?
Yeah, that's right.
More than once.
So you're doing this then?
On the right track. So
and
you got
to see in there somewhere, too.
There's
that it.
I'm playing a standard G diminished 7. When I cue you, play that chord just for a second. As it. So we have this.
Wow, you can move that thing too.
Well, yeah, all diminished colors are movable, even when the extensions.
Now, it looked like you did something like a major triad.
Oh, I know. I'm going to show you this in just a second. I didn't
lose Sorry.
Something. So, you understand how you can take any voice and put an extension in there in lieu of that note.
Right. Right.
So what I did is the alto voice rather, this G.
Okay.
I just threw the extension in instead, the upper extension.
Okay. So
what would that give us?
Oh yeah. That would
so
give
what
you
I did,
an A major chord.
I just
played B flat bass.
Yeah, I just kind of used 2 fingers because I wasn't worried about sustaining the counterpoint there. And then I just followed it with the symmetrical triad. First isn't strings or frets, because that you're processing automatically. It's fingers.
the fingering.
You have to store away and say, oh, that's the fingering with this cat. Kept using the middle finger in the bass. The thing is sound. I wouldn't have brought the subject up. It's just you can't get...
That's a good point.
If you have this stock chord, you want to go... There's certain counterpoint lines that I did hearing that require certain fingerings. Now it's just how the fingers are set up compared to the next tuning. Like, here's a typical thing that you'd hear for diminished in the 40s and 50s. Actually, in the 50s is probably when you hear this. This sound was found to be conversant in a musical way with all those dominant chords that live behind it by the extension process. So people might use two of them in a row, you know?
Like a...
The lines would just sustain, you know? So that, that kind of has that dominant... heavy dominant vibe, but in a place, it's not just like guys sitting around here. It's cooler, somehow. So
you
the process...
A lot of movement.
Yeah, the process here, though, is helped out by the particular fingering you chose, which is the second finger on string 5. Your way of putting the first finger is excellent for certain other things, and I can see then why
you get some high melodies.
You got it. You got it.
Yeah.
For a Lenny kind of thing, which is where we were coming from, this would be his diminished sound probably anyway.
Interesting.
I never sat with him and asked him about every diminished voice, but he seemed to like this kind of stuff.
It was easy on the as far as on the fingers.
yeah, he was.
But
his chords looked easy.
When
you see
time.
Him on the videos, it looks. His voicings look easy. George's look pretty easy. Wes's look easy. Wes's were easy. But all three
but
of those
guys. But he played them so fast.
Yeah, that's what. And Ed Bickert's look easy too, you know.
Who's that?
Ed Bickert.
I haven't had the pleasure of seeing him.
Love watching him. He's real smooth. All four of those guys look smooth as silk, nothing hard. It's not like watching Michael Hedges play, or one of those guys where you can tell something complicated is going on.
Hi.
What's going on? Okay, good. I wasn't. Because you didn't sound happy. Now you sound happier. No. Well, a little bit earlier. It was a fire or something. I am. Promise. Thanks. Me too. Bye. Okay.
I'm sorry.
I'm sorry. You asked me what you need.
I was just going to ask you one thing. That do keys play a lot in the choices here? Because I know Lenny, a lot of times, did want to get the bass notes when he was playing solo.
Open string.
You know,
keys.
Yeah, he would do things like that.
Well, that's just his style. They play a part if a person wishes them to, and if a person doesn't, they don't have to, especially you with the 7th string. You don't have any restrictions anymore. If I'm tuned all the way up to pitch, I've already made a concession to the planet so I can teach guitar and not offend. I make life miserable for my students when they go home with tapes and try to transcribe. Because some guys, they've got locking nuts and one guitar, and they don't want to constantly keep changing the tuning. The intonation keeps going out.
Keep it.
Tuning the intonation, I don't know. But
the point is,
I would probably play in keys that did have open strings even more when I'm tuned up to pitch, so I could get some extra resonance that the guitar wouldn't have by virtue of just how low it is. With your setup, you don't have any worries. Every key is rich and deep.
But if I was doing the Lenny thing, like let's suppose I was doing something in E minor and I was going, lines.
Let me stop you mid-flight now. If you're talking about all those fourths and all that stuff, that can only be done in certain open keys. That's a given.
Okay.
There's no question. We don't even have a question about that. That's like
with bass, you mean?
Yeah.
Right. Okay.
I mean, there's just some things that you don't have enough fingers left.
That's right.
That's a given. But as far as getting a rich tone and a beautiful vibe, a lot of times guys choose the open keys because they sound so good. But in your case, having the 7th, you're in good shape. All the keys sound good. That's all I meant. But yeah, certain physiological devices just can't be done unless you have open strings ringing below it if you want a deep bass. We just don't have enough fingers.
I think really, you know, what you said before about mixing it up is really the answer to solo guitar, you know.
I like that.
Because, people might get bored, and you might get bored if it's
absolutely
the same approach.
That's what I feel. I love George, I love Lenny, I love Phil the group, but I can't listen all night to any one of them, believe it or not. As much as I can't take a whole night of any one of their playing. Although, close with George, because he's got so much history there. I'm always waiting. I've seen Lenny play many times. I didn't get a chance to see George live in performance many times. I took lessons, of course. George always seems to have some surprises waiting. That third album he did for Capitol, did you ever hear that? It's called Soliloquy.
Yes, I have.
There are moments on there that just transcends what anybody's ever thought about for solo guitar.
I know.
There's just things, so much stuff moving around, these landmasses moving, you know. It's just.
Yeah.
But still, as great as George is, you know, a whole night of it, there's not enough variety of tone. Register, I hear too much bass. I don't hear enough. It's not his fault, that's just the sound he loves, so I'm with you, man.
Sure.
I want to hear variety on
it. Well, that's this whole thing, but the thing is, when I get together with him, and he stops playing, and I have to play, I'm, you know, with him, I'm doing all this stuff. I'm doing this, the walking thing, and the contrast, getting out of that, I want to keep the walking going, you know.
But, Bill Evans doesn't always walk, right?
True.
He's
true. Well, yeah, that's true, and sometimes I'm not walking when I'm playing with him, because I feel I do some halftime stuff, or, you know, at least for the head, maybe, or something.
You're playing. You get the listener in the game first by little brushes with the beat. Little inferences of the pulse.
Mm. That's nice.
Pretty soon, they're with it. You can just do this, like Bill would do.
They like that, because, yeah.
They're waiting. They're still subconsciously hungry. People want, I shouldn't overgeneralize, but I notice in this culture, people like a lot of intensity if they can have it. So they're waiting for the pulse to come back. They enjoy it. But they'll live without it for a while because they're doing the pulse in their body.
Yeah.
They're going, you know, they're sitting there grooving with you. Don't do that for 3 minutes in a row. 1 minute. Then the next, I mean, I don't mean these as commands, suggestions, thoughts. After this for a while, maybe you bring this back, tease the ear for a little while. Change rhythms,
like
right?
Feels or something.
Yeah. What happened here to the tuning? Cross rhythms.
Yeah.
That keeps people pleasantly confused, I find, including myself. Where the hell's the beat? But it's something. I mean, we're still locked into something there for a moment.
That's great.
We're just waiting. I mean, what is this? You know, you go, what song is this guy playing? Justly so, if I'm in a club, man, are they ever going to play a song?
And they're setting it up,
they're tapping. Wow. See, I took the pulse away because they don't need it every moment.
Yeah.
I need a rest. Otherwise, I'm going to not be able to keep it going at that intensity forever, so I say to myself, well, without running out of ideas is my problem. So I would just start getting the same stuff, playing the same stuff. Not because I would plan it, it would just have to. It's all sounding
yeah,
the same.
You just start
but
feeling
really what it is that texture starts to
change.
Because it's just one tone, one guy. Sometimes I switch tones in the middle and get some more raucous tone, which changes the whole vibe. Sometimes that's the antidote. But when the tempo is moving that fast, I'm usually in over my head anyway, and I'm just barely surviving, man, to be honest with me, personally.
Well, me too. I've sort of entertained thoughts.
To you
no, I was just going to say, I've entertained thoughts of trying to to work this thing up, you know, like the, you know, that sort of Lenny thing where
it's one of my
I'm not that great at it,
well.
You know, but
you mean chime chords?
Yeah, trying to get that,
not the harp,
the second in there, and comping like that. That would be a neat thing to work on.
I do work with it. I enjoy this. Trouble is my thumbnails are all shot to hell. I think
you know,
just,
sometimes I can't get it loud enough, you know.
My thumbnail has to be there for me to get it real loud. Let's see about this tune. And when I did this, what I do is I play a bass note and let it float free and then hit a four note chord. Just to get a little more resonance if I'm playing by myself. Oh, thumbnail key is gonna fail me. This is two notes floating free and then four over it.
Uh-huh. Yeah, it's two to do that.
Clusters. So you like clusters, huh?
Well, I think I have to work on voicings, believe it or not, because
but I mean, you like the sound of two.
I like
notes
that.
A
I like that
apart,
a lot.
Huh?
You know, because you're jumping to these chords like right away, and with the Van Epps approach, it's totally it's like a different thing, you know.
Each, like I said, each cat is so different.
Yeah.
The voicing thing is more of a Lenny approach, no doubt. I was influenced by that.
So how are you? Thinking when you play those chords, are you thinking, okay, like let's say you're trying to play some F7 altered, do you build it from the tritone and then think of some notes on top of that, like you say, okay, I'm building it from the tritone, I'm putting a sharp 5 in and a 9th in or something?
I'll try to answer it.
Okay.
I worked in a lot of different ways by semi-systematic process. Sometimes real systematic, sometimes all ear and luck and mistakes and wow, what was that? But eventually I codified it so that I got it in my head that there's sizes of chords. So I choose by size. The color is a given. I want to have certain colors, so I want to choose this thing. But it's like if I want F7, do I want it to go bong, bong? I'm singing the wrong.
Right, just a regular.
Is this F? Okay. Like this is size number 5. This is what I call, this belongs to a series of chords. If you study George's books, you study chords of this size.
Right.
This is what I just happen to call part of voicing room 5. You say play F9 rows. Like this sounds like a big F9 chord, a big row of something that, in a composite sense, sounds like we're playing. But this is in a size, a particular spread, right? Whereas, say, voicing room 4 is this size, which I know you're aware of too, just the regular standard guitar size. And then the tiny size that's not tiny completely, you know, size 2, you know, like this size, the Wes Montgomery's.
Yes.
Joe Pass.
Okay.
This whole thing. Standard jazz guitar, tiny guys. Then you have your closer one, size number 1, the closest way you can voice chords.
Now, is this in some of your books? Is this like in modern chord progression?
The incipient form of it showed up in 1971 in chord chemistry. But I was a young guy and I was foolish and lazy. Other than that, I was fine.
I don't know about lazy.
No, I started to burn out, man. In the middle of the book, I just I would sit and get these horrible headaches and stuff from cross-checking all these chord names and stuff. And if I had stayed with it 2 more months, you would have had the system in there because I was onto it, but I was afraid it would work because I realized what I was up against. It wasn't as awesome as I thought. When I really got down the trenches, it wasn't as bad as I thought. I pictured this thing of like, you know, 100,000 chords or something, but it wasn't like that. But still, the number scheme isn't very pleasant. It's a lot, but it's not that bad.
So you're kind of just instantly getting the chord.
We don't want to give me too much credit. I mean, there are a lot of chords that I'm aware of, and there are a lot that I could, if somebody said, now here, you have 1 minute to remember it, then I could get it. But that's...